Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shingles Audio Collection, Volume 3, by Robert Bevan, Rick Gualtieri, Steve Wetherell, and Drew Hayes. Narrated by Cal Wembly and Cassandra Myles. Wax On, Wax Off, by Robert Bevan. 1. "Hey, sport," said Dad, glancing up from his Hustle Whore magazine as I limped through the back door. "How was school?" "Okay, I guess." I was hoping he'd notice my bleeding elbow and black eye, but his attention was firmly focused on the article he was reading and whatever he was doing with his hand under the table.
"Is that the FedEx guy?"
shouted Mom through a haze of cigarette smoke coming from the bedroom.
"Don't you let him leave without paying that $7.50 he owes me. The nerve of him trying to pay me with a credit card like I got a chip reader in my cooch. I told him I'll take it in the rear, but I don't take American ex—"
She stopped when she staggered into the kitchen and saw me.
"God damn, Donnie. The fuck happened to you? You sass your daddy?"
I shook my head. Bert Fargle pummeled me again after school. Mom went into a coughing fit, spat a big gob of phlegm into the sink, then took a long drag on her cigarette.
"Well, you better stop bleeding on my kitchen table before I give you something to bleed about."
I picked up the roll of toilet paper next to Dad and started unrolling some.
"Not too much," said Mom. "We ain't the goddamn Rockefellers."
I pulled off three squares and bunched it against the scrape on my elbow. Mom put her cigarette out in the phlegm gob in the sink, then lit up another one.
"Gilbert, you seen your son?"
"Just a fucking minute, Jolene," said Dad between heavy breaths. "I swear, a man can't even get no privacy in his own goddamn kitchen."
Mom blew out a long stream of smoke and shook her head.
"That's just like you, Gilbert. Our son's turning into a giant fucking pussy right before our eyes, and all you can think about is twins pissing on each other."
"Just, God damn mother fucking—"
He closed his eyes and sighed heavily.
"Oh, God. Oh, God."
He opened his eyes and grabbed the roll of toilet paper, which he quickly shoved under the table.
"All right, already. Now where's the goddamn fire?"
"Would you take a look at your son?" said Mom.
Dad turned toward me.
"Jesus Christ, Donnie, you look like your goddamn sister."
"Gilbert!"
"I have a sister?" I asked.
"Your daddy's just exaggerating," said Mom. "We aborted her."
Dad stood up and playfully pretend punched Mom in the belly.
"What do you mean, we? As I recall, I did all the dirty work."
Mom laughed.
"Well, according to the official report, I'm the one who fell down the stairs."
"We have stairs?" I asked. I couldn't recall our trailer having a second floor. Dad shook his head.
"Boy, you're about as smart as you is tough."
I could taste blood in my mouth as I beamed at him.
"Thanks, Dad."
While he was in such a generous mood, I thought it would be a good time for me to bring up my idea for a solution to the problem.
"What do you think of me taking karate lessons?"
"Karate?" Dad scoffed. "Does this look like fucking China to you? Do you see any fucking dragons flying around?"
"There's a karate school just on the other side of the railroad tracks," I persisted. "I can get a job and pay for it myself."
Dad sighed.
"Donnie, them people don't even accept American money. All they take is yin-yangs. If you want to learn how to fight, I suggest you go face off with Bert Fargle again, only this time not like a goddamn queer."
I tried hard to think of a way that I might earn some yin-yangs, but I couldn't come up with anything. So instead, I blurted out the next best thing that came to mind.
"I could work for the old Chinaman who lives on the corner. I bet he could teach me karate." "You get that thought out of your head right now, young man," said Mom. "Ain't no son of mine gonna suck no Chinaman dick."
I didn't even know how to respond to that.
I was thinking more like I'd rake his leaves or something.
Listen, honey, said Mom. I'm on my way to see Mr. Fargo right now while his wife's busy having their third baby. You want I should ask him to tell Bert to stop beating the shit out of you on account of you being retarded?
Am I retarded?
Dad shrugged. I mean, if you gotta ask.
Mom pinched my cheek as she blew a cloud of smoke in my face.
Of course you ain't retarded, sweetie. I whacked off four big colored fellers to haul this house to the other side of the creek so we could live in a better school district. You only seem stupid compared to the other kids in your class.
Thanks, Mom. My eyes were beginning to water from the cigarette smoke.
God damn it, Donny, said Dad. What did I tell you about crying like a little bitch?
I coughed.
It attracts queers.
Too fucking right it does. They can smell little bitch boy tears a mile away. Don't you forget that.
Yes, sir.
Dad nodded.
Now run on down to the quick fix and pick me up a case of Coors Light.
Mom belched out a smoke ring.
And grab me some more Marlboro Reds.
Okay. I can't say I relished the idea of going to the quick fix at this time of day. Bert Fargle and his gang were probably hanging out in the parking lot. But another beating from him would be better than what I could expect from talking back to my parents. Keeping pressure on the blood-soaked tissue covering my elbow, I shoved the back door open with my butt and headed back outside.
2. Mom and Dad never give me any money for beer and cigarettes. They say that the challenge of figuring out how to steal them builds critical thinking skills, and that I can't yet be tried as an adult. So I went the long way to scope out quick fix from behind. Even if I had money, I probably would have taken that route anyway. It made an encounter with Bert Fargle's gang less likely. Passing the old Chinaman's house at the end of the street, I thought again about asking him to teach me karate. But I didn't have the nerve to go knock on his door. I only knew a few phrases in Chinese, and I'm pretty sure they was all made up when me and my friends used to stretch our eyelids out wide and make faces through the window of the Five Dragons restaurant. Still, the thought of kicking Bert Fargle's ass made me stop walking. Surely realizing that dream was worth a bit of nervous pantomiming. There was a brown car in the driveway, but the house looked like it hadn't been lived in for years. The windows were dark, the paint was peeling, and the hedges in front of the porch were massively overgrown. The whole place gave me kind of a creepy vibe. I paused only briefly, then kept walking. After a hike through the woods, I finally saw the rear of the quick fix. Even better, I spotted Gary the hobo tugging on his wiener next to the dumpster. That was going to make my job a lot easier. There's not a whole lot Gary wouldn't do if I agreed to watch him pee on a dead animal.
Hey, Gary!
I called out from a distance in case his rabies was acting up. He turned around, quickly pulling his pants up over his wiener and rolling up the same issue of Hustle Whore that my dad had been reading.
Oh, it's you.
He still sounded a little jumpy, but didn't look displeased to see me. Got any new dead animals around?
Do I ever! Fought a fat-ass coon to death over a half-eaten Slim Jim this morning. Been drinking puddle water all day to fill my bladder. You want to watch?
I decided to lay my cards on the table. I was kind of hoping you'd run distraction while I swiped a case of beer and a carton of cigarettes. Gary pressed his lips together and nodded.
Nobody appreciates a good show anymore. Everybody wants something. Well, kid, you've got yourself a deal. Just give me a minute to finish up.
He grinned and shook his rolled-up magazine.
New Hustle Whore. Twins pissing on each other.
Take your time, I said. Gary turned around and continued to try to yank his wiener off while he read his magazine. As many times as I'd seen him try, he never succeeded, but he really seemed to enjoy the challenge. I supposed there was something to say for continuing to chase that dream, no matter how excruciating success would be.
Heavy breathing led to the all-too-familiar sigh of defeat.
Then Gary squatted down and pulled an impressively large dead raccoon out from under the dumpster.
You ready?
I laughed. No way, Gary. You know I'll hold up my end of the deal. Last time I let you go first, you started foaming at the mouth and tried to bite me.
I told you that wasn't me.
He pulled his left jacket sleeve up to reveal the festering bite wound that had been getting progressively more gross-looking in the 6 months that I'd known him.
It was the disease.
I crossed my arms and raised my eyebrows skeptically. Gary sighed again.
Fine. We'll do your thing first. Wait here.
He buttoned his pants, then tiptoed around the corner toward the front of the store. A few seconds later, the commotion started. Through the quick fix's back door, I could hear the muffled screams of customers as Gary growled at them and chased them up and down the aisles.
"Damn it, Gary!" shouted old man Puckett. "What did I tell you about coming in here and biting my customers?"
He was 87 years old and nearly blind, so Gary really had to put on a show. I backed away from the door and crouched down next to the dumpster, just in time to avoid Gary as he shoved the door open and started running toward the woods. As always, old man Puckett was only a few steps behind him, gun in hand.
"You son of a bitch!"
he shouted hoarsely, then opened fire. During the distraction, I slipped behind him into the open back door. Gary's performance not only got rid of old man Puckett for a few precious seconds, but it also cleared all the customers out of the store. The case of Coors Light was easy enough to grab, but the cigarettes were a little more challenging, situated above the counter. As slow as old man Puckett was, and as much as he enjoyed shooting at Gary, I was always worried that he was going to come back in and catch me standing on the counter. Today, I was in luck. There were cases of cigarettes behind the counter that he hadn't stocked yet. I grabbed a few cartons of Marlboro Reds. I wouldn't give them to Mom all at once. I'd just give her what she asked for, but stash a few in my room for the next few times she sent me out. As I was hurrying to the back door, I spotted the latest issue of Hustle Horror in the magazine rack. Curious as to what article my dad and Gary the Hobo found so interesting, I swiped a copy of that as well. When I got outside with my haul, Gary was still running back and forth by the edge of the woods, and old man Puckett was still firing shots at him, or at least in his general direction. I crouched down on the other side of the dumpster, then gave Gary the thumbs up. With the next shot old man Puckett fired, Gary fell backward and landed flat on the ground. It was an impressive performance, and I was kind of worried that old man Puckett had actually hit him.
"Goddamn hobos,"
old man Puckett muttered as he hobbled back into his store. After the door closed behind him, I was relieved when Gary lifted his head and returned my thumbs up. Gary didn't look too good as he limped back to the dumpster. At first, I thought maybe he'd hit the ground too hard, but then I saw that he was bleeding from the chest, up near his shoulder.
"Gary!" I cried. "Are you okay? Did he actually hit you?"
Gary shrugged.
"Every now and again he gets a lucky shot. I barely feel it."
He punched the wound a couple of times to demonstrate how little it hurt.
"One of the perks of rabies, I suppose."
He stood over his dead raccoon.
"If you want to know what's really killing me right now, it's my bladder."
I smiled. "Ready when you are, Gary." While I can't say I enjoyed watching Gary pee on a dead raccoon on its own merit, I was happy to provide him the enjoyment of having an audience right after he'd just literally taken a bullet for me. That happiness came to a screeching halt when Bert Fargle and his gang came around the corner of the shop. 3.
"Well, well, well," snarled Bert. "Look at what we have here."
His toadies chuckled.
"Gather round, children," said Gary. "I'm only just getting started."
His stream was strong and steamy as it splattered against the raccoon carcass. Bert narrowed his eyes as he took a step toward me.
Do you know what we do with little bitch babies who like to watch hobos piss on dead raccoons?
The question caught me off guard. Does that situation really come up often enough for you to have established protocol?
We beat the shit out of them.
I supposed this specific situation fell under a pretty wide umbrella. Bert Fargle didn't seem like the sort who liked to compartmentalize, and beating the shit out of people seemed to be his default reaction to most things. I picked up Dad's beer and Mom's smokes, then ran as fast as I could for the trees. When I glanced back, I was relieved to find that Bert's entire entourage was fixated on watching Gary pee on the dead raccoon.
"He's getting away," said Bert. "Don't just stand there. Let's get him."
The forest wasn't dense enough for me to lose them in the cover of tree trunks, but I knew where the narrowest point of the creek was. Hoping I might be able to gain a bit more of a lead while they got stuck looking for a place to cross, I headed that way.
"He went this way," said Chris Barnes.
Hearing his voice in the crowd stung my heart. He was one of the kids who used to make faces through the window of the Chinese restaurant with me. He only joined Bert Fargle's gang to stop getting the shit beat out of him.
"We gotta get those cigarettes," said Brad Madison. "Do you know what his mom will do for a single pack?"
I considered dropping a carton, but that would only slow down one of them at best. Getting the shit beat out of me by five guys wasn't a whole lot different than getting the shit beat out of me by six guys. The case of beer was getting really heavy in my arms, and I barely made the jump across the creek. I really hoped Dad wasn't planning to crack one of these open right when I got home. They were going to need some time to settle. Turning back in the direction of my street, I shot a sideways glance at my pursuers. They were closer than I'd expected, running straight toward me instead of turning for the narrower part of the creek. Their faces reminded me of hungry wolves. I couldn't believe my eyes as they leaped over a section of creek I would never have been able to clear. I supposed that made sense, seeing as how they were all a lot more athletic than me and not weighed down with a case of beer. That reminded me of what was at stake. If I let them catch up to me, they would pound the shit out of me and take my beer and smokes. Then my parents would pound the shit out of me for coming back home empty-handed. Failure wasn't an option. I pushed myself to the absolute limit as I ran for my life. My heart felt like it was going to explode, and my lungs couldn't take in oxygen fast enough. Just when I thought I was going to black out, I spotted the last bend in the path. If I could get out of their line of sight for just a few seconds, I might be able to find somewhere to hide. Visualizing the end of my street in my mind, I suddenly knew the perfect place. With a renewed sense of hope, I ran like hell, darted through the Chinaman's open gate, then ducked behind his car. My heart was still pounding. Not daring to look back as I ran, I had no idea if Bert and his gang saw me. If they caught me trying to hide, the beating was going to be that much worse.
"Where did he go?" said Bert.
He was just on the other side of the fence. I could smell his sweaty pits.
"He couldn't have gone far," said Larry Fine. "He's got to be around here somewhere."
Bert's sneakers stopped right in front of where I was hiding.
"Come on out, Donny douche-rag!"
Did he see me? Was he looking right at me? I kept my eyes closed and concentrated on not peeing.
"Give us that case of beer and I promise we'll let you walk away."
The rest of his gang chuckled, which did not lend credibility to his promise.
"Come on, Donny. We're going to find you sooner or later, and when we do, you're not going to..." "Shit!" cried Chris. "In the window!"
I glanced back instinctively to find the old Chinaman staring right at me, his dragon-like gaze boring into my soul. If I hadn't been paralyzed with fear, I might have run out into the street and taken my chances with Bert's gang.
An old Chinaman, said Larry.
He and I had stopped making faces in the window of the Chinese restaurant when my dad told us what those people were capable of.
Let's get out of here before he puts a curse on us!
The curtain closed as Bert and his gang ran away. I gathered up all the cigarette cartons and picked up the case of beer and was about to leave when I heard the front door creak open. I couldn't even fathom the amount of shit I was in. Was I standing on the grave of his ancient ancestors? Burying them under the driveway seemed like an odd thing to do, but their people had mysterious ways.
Hey, kid, someone said.
The voice sounded old, but not very Chinese.
What are you doing behind my car?
I stood up nervously.
I'm really sorry, mister.
I suddenly realized that I didn't know this guy's name. I was about to gamble on the probability of it being Ching Chong, but then I spotted it on the back of his car.
Mr. Mitsubishi?
Mr. Mitsubishi glanced down at his car, then stared at me.
I didn't mean to trespass on the graves of your ancestors. I swear it.
Since I was already here, I figured I might as well ask.
I was hoping you could teach me karate.
Karate? What the hell makes you think I know anything about...
Mr. Mitsubishi paused in thought, stroking his wispy white beard. Then he shrugged.
Ah, yes, karate. I know much well. Ancient art of my people.
He sounded like a proper Chinaman now. I gawked at him for a moment.
Did you just forget how to speak English?
Mr. Mitsubishi slapped me across the face.
Ow!
First lesson, never let guard down.
I rubbed my cheek and nodded. Thank you, Mr. Mitsubishi.
Why you want learn karate?
There are these kids at school. They won't stop picking on me.
Yes, yes. I see you hide here like little bitch baby.
I thought maybe if I broke all their spines, they'd leave me alone.
Mr. Mitsubishi nodded slowly and stroked his beard.
Very good reason. Noble and just.
I don't have any yin-yangs to pay you with, but I thought maybe I could do some yard work for you or something.
I couldn't offer him my dad's beer, but since I'd swiped a few extra cartons of cigarettes for Mom, I thought I might sweeten the pot with that. I picked one up and held it out to him.
And this.
He accepted the carton and stared at it for a moment.
Marlboro Red. Very good. What's your name?
Donny.
Now? Your name is Donny-san. You come here tomorrow morning, Donny-san. I teach you karate.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mitsubishi.
I gathered the beer and the rest of the smokes, then ran the rest of the way home. By this time tomorrow, I would know karate. 4.
That you, Donny?
Dad called out when I opened the back door.
Yeah, Dad.
I set the Coors Light down on the table, then hurriedly tossed all but one of the cigarette cartons into my room.
You get that beer?
Sure did. No trouble at all, except Gary the hobo got shot a little.
Bring me one, would you?
I opened the box, hoping the beer had had enough time to settle while I walked home from Mr. Mitsubishi's house.
Where are you?
In the shitter. Hurry up.
Tapping on the top of the can before opening it was supposed to make the fizz settle down. At least I'd heard that somewhere before. I tapped it all the way from the kitchen to the open door of the bathroom. Dad was on the toilet, and it smelled like he'd been there for a while. I handed him the beer.
I got Mom's cigarettes, too. Where is she?
Out sucking dick, said Dad. Just leave them on the table.
Sure thing.
I backed out, keeping my eyes on the beer as if I'd just handed him a live grenade. For some reason, he didn't immediately open it.
Ah,
he said when I was halfway back to the kitchen.
Nothing like a good cold one on the balls.
I flinched when I heard the can finally crack open, but the long slurp and lack of swearing that followed suggested that the foam explosion was minimal. After I finished putting the rest of the cans in the fridge, I went to my room to hide the cigarette cartons more carefully.
Mom's working late tonight,
Dad shouted from the bathroom.
Supper's in the freezer.
When I opened the freezer door, I found a half-full bag of Totino's pizza rolls.
Whoa, I said. These are name brand.
Dad laughed.
Mom swiped them from the Fargo's freezer on her way out after sucking Mr. Fargo's dick.
I didn't think anything could top name brand pizza rolls for dinner, but knowing they were Bert Fargo's pizza rolls was the greatest seasoning of all. Figuring that Dad was going to want some too, I put what was left of the bag in the microwave.
God damn, boy,
said Dad after he flushed and the smell of pizza rolls began to overtake the smell coming from the bathroom.
Those smell good. You know, I always thought you was pretty worthless, but I reckon maybe there's a chef in you yet.
My dad wasn't the type to hand out praise like that all willy-nilly, so him saying that warmed my heart like the inside of a delicious Totino's pizza roll. After dinner, I washed the dish while Dad took off his pants, sat on the sofa, and opened his laptop. I think I'm going to turn in early, I said. I couldn't wait for tomorrow to come. Plus, learning karate was probably going to take up most of the day, so I wanted to be well rested. Dad paused the video he was watching, stopped whatever he was doing with his other hand, and looked back at me.
Huh?
I had a pretty long day, and I'm pretty beat, so I think I'm going to go to bed now. Dad shrugged.
And why do I give a shit?
Let
me ask you a question, Donnie. Have you ever tried to whack off to a 400-pound Mexican woman taking a piss on a dead armadillo?
I tried recalling any past experiences that might even come close to whatever he was talking about. No, sir, I don't think so.
Well, it takes concentration, Donnie. Focus. And right now, you're breaking my concentration.
Sorry, Dad. I didn't mean...
Get me a beer and then go to your room. If I hear another word out of you tonight, my dong ain't the only thing I'll be whacking. You hear me, boy?
Yes, sir, I said as I hurried to the fridge to grab a beer. Then I clapped my hand over my mouth, hoping that hadn't counted as hearing another word out of me. Thankfully, when I returned with the beer, he was thoroughly entranced with his video. I put the beer down on the coffee table, then ran to my room and shut the door behind me. I tried as hard as I could to go to sleep, but I was too excited. Thinking a bit of light reading might help me relax, I opened up the copy of Hustle Horror I'd swiped from Quick Fix. I flipped through the pages, but there wasn't much in there to read at all. Just a bunch of pictures of naked people. Some of them were alone in strange poses, while others looked to be wrestling with each other. The pages in the middle, as promised, featured two identical twin women peeing on each other. But as hard as I searched, I couldn't seem to find any story associated with it. In fact, some of the only writing I found in the whole magazine was a full-page ad for Hello Titty, a new store that had recently opened up in town. I remembered Dad mentioning something about how much it was going to bring in to the local economy. I couldn't understand what my dad and Gary the Hobo found so fascinating about this magazine. To me, it was just kind of boring and a little gross. "What you reading?" asked the voice of an angel from my open bedroom window. I looked up to find Wendy Peters staring back at me, then quickly thrust Hustle Whore down on the other side of my bed. I tried to think of something more intellectual from my dad's collection in the bathroom. It's the latest issue of Dry Humpin'. I think it's good that you like to read, said Wendy. Maybe you could teach me someday? I felt a sudden warmth in my cheeks at the thought of being so close to Wendy Peters, the most beautiful girl in the trailer park, for as long as it would take to teach her basic literacy. "Sure," I said, trying not to sound too overly enthusiastic. "I'd love to." Then a thought occurred to me. "What are you doing outside my window?" Wendy lit up a cigarette and took a long drag. "Shitter's clogged. I came over to take a dump in your yard. Some of the weeds you got growing out here have really pretty flowers, and Mama says there ain't nothing flowers like more than a big old shit." I smiled and sighed. "That was really thoughtful of you." Wendy patted her swollen belly where it poked out under her halter top and took another drag of her cigarette. "And I figured the night air was good for Reggie Jr." "Oh, so you confirmed that your cousin Reggie is the father?" "Who knows," said Wendy. "But Mama says if I name the baby after him, he'll have to pay child support." "That's smart thinking." Wendy frowned and stared at a cockroach on the windowsill. "I heard Bert Fargle beat the shit out of you again." I gulped. "You did?" "It's all he could talk about when I was whacking him and his friends off behind the bowling alley." It was thoughtful of her to stand up for me like that, if not a little bit emasculating. Still, I couldn't help but smile at the thought of it. "Did you whack them hard?" Wendy stared at me for a second, as if I was speaking in mathematical equations, then smiled back. "Yeah, Donnie, I whacked them real good." "Well, don't you worry about me," I said. "After tomorrow, I'll be whacking them myself." "Oh?" Wendy flicked her cigarette butt toward our front yard. "You reckon that's the best way to get them to stop picking on you?" I nodded. "I can't wait. I'll whack them one by one, two at a time, or even all at once, however they want to come at me. And I'll keep on whacking them until they stop coming." "I'd better be getting back home now," said Wendy. "You take care of yourself, Donnie, and maybe give this plan of yours a little more thought." "You can count on that." In fact, that's all I could think about until I finally drifted off to sleep. 5. When I woke up the next morning, I already felt more powerful. Today was the day that was going to change my life. I was too excited to eat breakfast, and the pizza rolls from last night were still weighing heavy in my stomach. But imagining Bert Fargle frantically searching his freezer for pizza rolls made me appreciate the reminder that they were still inside me. I kind of felt like I had to poo, but I wasn't ready to let them go just yet. When I passed the bathroom door, I felt something metallic bounce off the side of my head. An empty Coors Light can clanged down on the linoleum next to me.
"Hey, retard," said Dad from the toilet. Judging by the smell, he'd had no qualms about letting go of the pizza rolls he'd eaten.
"Yeah, Dad?"
"Pick me up another case of beer while you're out."
He thought I was on my way to school, so he wouldn't be expecting me to return right away. That would leave me plenty of time to learn karate and steal some more beer. I smiled and gave him a thumbs up.
"You got it, Dad."
"Don't make that face, you look like a faggot."
I laughed to myself as I walked out into the brisk morning air. I bet he wouldn't call me that after word started spreading that I was whacking off all the boys in Bert Fargle's gang. "Good morning," I said when I arrived at Mr. Mitsubishi's house. He was on the front porch setting up some sort of harness or something. He jumped when I addressed him, then turned around.
"Oh, it's you. You scared the shit out of... hello, Donny-san. Now you training begin. Hurry now, join me on porch."
The hedges in front of the porch obscured everything below his waist, but when I got up there, it appeared that Mr. Mitsubishi had just gotten home from shopping. The biggest bag was from Hello Titty. I recognized the logo from the ad in Hustle Whore. Next to it, sitting on a small wooden table, I spotted a book called useful Asian stereotypes.
What's that?
I asked. His gaze fell to the book.
Nothing.
He quickly shoved the book into a brown paper bag.
Ancient secrets. Shut up!
I'm sorry, I...
Path to enlightenment not come from ask stupid questions.
Mr. Mitsubishi held up his fists.
It come from here.
Then he reached down and grabbed his crotch with both hands.
And here.
His broken English sounded so wise. This guy was the real deal. Yes, Mr. Mitsubishi, I understand.
You no call me Mr. Mitsubishi.
He pulled his book out of his bag, turned away from me, and flipped through some of the pages. Then he put the book back in the bag and faced me again.
You call me Sensei.
I must have made a good impression on him. I couldn't believe we were already on a first-name basis. He pulled something out of the bag, but it wasn't the book. It was a black cord, all rolled up. He held it in front of my face.
You know what is?
Not entirely sure I even understood the question, I shook my head.
Is black belt.
I tried to think of what I'd done to piss him off. You gonna beat me with it?
No,
Sensei thought for a moment.
Not yet, anyway.
He unrolled it and tied it in a loop.
Is reward for complete you training. When you wear this, you are karate master.
A brilliant idea occurred to me.
Then why don't I just wear it now and we can skip the training?
Sensei slapped me across the face with the looped belt. It was a lot softer than the belt my dad beat me with.
Belt no give. Must be earned.
He tied the non-looped end of the belt to the contraption he'd been working on when I first arrived, so that the loop hung down right over his chair. I was about to ask what he was doing, but he started talking again.
But first, must earn lesser belts.
He turned over another bag, and a bunch of different colored belts spilled out.
For every task complete, you earn new belt.
Wow, I said, staring down at all the belts. Becoming a karate master is going to take hours.
Now you take yellow belt.
But I haven't completed any tasks yet.
Sensei nodded.
Yellow belt mark you as little bitch baby. Put on and take off shirt.
I picked up the yellow belt and wrapped it around my waist. Is there a special way I'm supposed to tie this? Sensei waved dismissively.
However work best for you. Now take off shirt.
Why do I have to take off my shirt?
Smack!
So engrossed in trying to tie my belt, I didn't see his hand coming. It was like a bolt of lightning against my cheek. He really was a karate master.
What I tell you about stupid questions. True warrior never fight with shirt on.
My limited exposure to martial arts movies seemed to confirm this.
I'm sorry, Sensei. Of course you're right.
I took off my shirt. Sensei nodded slowly as he gazed at my chest and belly. It made me a little uncomfortable.
You look like Pillsburg Doughchild. I like very much.
I sighed with relief. I was afraid I'd disappointed him again.
So what's my first task?
I asked, eager to get my training underway. Sensei removed a large plastic bucket from the Hello Titty bag.
First, you wax my car.
Is that part of the training, or is that what you want me to do as payment?
Both.
I looked at the bucket. The label said, Boner Bob's All-Purpose Lube.
I don't think that's car wax.
Smack!
When the world stopped spinning and my eyes readjusted, Sensei was pointing at the label.
All-Purpose!
He took off the lid, scooped out a handful, then thrust the bucket at me.
Is there a special technique I should use? I asked, accepting the bucket.
You rub all over body, then rub body on car.
That doesn't seem like a very efficient...
I caught myself as Sensei raised his hand to strike me.
Perhaps that's why he didn't follow through with it, or maybe it was because he didn't want to waste his handful of lube. It didn't matter much. Thankful not to be slapped again, I hurried down the steps and set the lube bucket on the hood of his car. I scooped out two handfuls and slathered my chest, belly, back, and arms as well as I could. It sure was slippery. Then I looked back at him. Like this?
Put on face too,
said Sensei, as he sat down with the black belt around his neck. When he sat down, I couldn't see anything below his neck above the hedges. He started breathing heavily as I smeared the clear, gooey liquid on my face.
Oh yes, very nice. You good little bitch, baby. Now rub body on car.
Figuring the hood would be the easiest place to get started, I did my best to rub my lube-smeared body against it like I imagined a real karate master would. I felt like I was doing it all wrong, but supposed Sensei wasn't expecting miracles from a mere yellow belt. When the hood was mostly covered in lube, I started on the passenger side door, rubbing my chest against the window, still not confident that my technique was correct. Am I doing this right? I asked Sensei. He gave me a wide grin and a thumbs up, in spite of the fact that his face was beet red and his eyes were bulging. It almost seemed like the black belt was too tight around his neck. Are you all right, Sensei? He nodded vigorously and thrust his thumb up even higher. Then, with the same hand, he pointed at the car. I couldn't see what he was doing with his other hand. Guessing his gesture meant that I should get back to work, I continued rubbing myself against the door. I was about to start on the back of the car when I heard heavy panting coming from the porch.
Enough, Donny-san,
said Sensei as he slipped the black belt off from around his neck. But I was just getting ready to lube up your rear. Sensei narrowed his eyes in thought for a moment.
No say that. You sound like faggot.
Oh, I only meant...
Come here, Donny-san. You earn green belt.
I certainly wasn't going to argue with that. I grabbed the lube bucket and ran up the porch steps as fast as I could.
Congratulations, said Sensei as he handed me the green belt.
Oh, boy! I tied the green belt around my waist. The ends of it hung down next to the ends of my yellow belt. I already felt more competent. What's next?
Next is break time.
As eager as I was to continue my training, I knew better than to question Sensei. And to be honest, I didn't mind taking a little breather. Sensei took two cans of lemonade out of another shopping bag and handed one to me. Thank you, Sensei. He nodded as he took a couple of little blue pills out of his pocket. What are those?
These for allergy. You shut up and mind your own business.
He cracked open his can and swallowed the pills with a gulp of lemonade. I cracked open my can as I noticed Sensei gawking down at his crotch like he was amazed or terrified of something there. Are you okay?
Son of a bitch! This good stuff!
Oh yeah? I had to admit, I was pretty thirsty. Some good lemonade would really hit the spot. I tilted my head back and started drinking.
Smack!
Lemonade sprayed out of my mouth as the can flew out of my hand into the front yard.
Break time over,
said Sensei, scrambling to put the black belt back around his neck. Oh, okay. What's my next task? Sensei did a quick scan of his yard.
Weatherproof fence.
Sure thing, I said. When he didn't follow up with anything further, I felt compelled to ask, with what? He scooped out a handful of lube from the bucket and held it up at me.
All purpose.
Oh, so should I use a brush or... Sensei rolled his eyes and sighed.
Rub on body. Rub body on fence.
I had a feeling that might have been the right answer, but I wanted to be sure. I picked up the bucket, jogged to the fence, spread a fresh layer of Boner Bob's all-purpose lube on my body, then got to work. Over the next couple of hours, I also fertilized Sensei's lawn, polished the cucumbers in his garden, insulated his windows, and even wrestled an inflatable practice adversary. The techniques for each were remarkably similar. I had no idea Boner Bob's all-purpose lube was so useful. I made a mental note to pick up a bucket for my dad sometime. Looking down at my collection of belts, I was impressed at how much I had learned already. I now had a yellow belt, a green belt, a blue belt, an orange belt, a purple belt, and a red belt. Their ends hung from my waist like a colorful hula skirt. I felt like a total badass.
"Enough for today," said Sensei as he removed the black belt from his neck again.
"Ah, shucks," I said. "I was really hoping to earn my black belt today." Sensei laughed weakly.
"You no become karate master in only one day, Donny-san. It take at least 2 day."
"Yes, Sensei." I didn't push the issue. Even though I'd been doing all the work, Sensei looked even more exhausted than I felt. It must have been his allergies. He'd been taking quite a lot of those pills. I reached for my shirt, but Sensei snatched it up before I could grab it. He held it up to his face and gave it a good long sniff.
"I keep this tonight. You return tomorrow. Complete training."
Now that I was a warrior, I wasn't shy about walking home shirtless. In fact, I actually hoped to run across Bert Fargle and his gang. When I arrived at my trailer, I was not disappointed. 6.
"What the shit-eating fuck?" said Bert as I approached.
He and the rest of the gang looked properly odd at my appearance. The power I felt over them was intoxicating.
"What happened to you, Donny?" asked Chris Barnes.
The expression on his face showed more concern than anyone else's. Perhaps he thought his betrayal would earn him an extra savage beating. If that was the case, he was right to be concerned. Then he grinned.
"You look like you just got bukkakied at a carnival."
The whole gang burst into a fit of laughter. I let them enjoy the last little moment of mirth they would ever have, once I let my fists fly and left them all crippled, quivering husks of their former selves on my front lawn.
"I heard you wanted to whack us off," said Bert once he got his laughter under control.
I licked my lips and squinted. There was no point in denying it now. Before I kicked their asses, though, I thought it would be fun to get them good and riled up with a little trash talk.
"And I heard you all got whacked off by Wendy Peters yesterday."
Bert shrugged, trying to play it off like it was no big deal.
"Yeah, we did."
"Ain't a whole lot that girl won't do for a pack of menthols," said Larry.
I raised my fists, still glistening with lube.
"Well, now you're about to find out what it's like to get whacked off by a man."
They all exchanged some awkward glances as if suddenly realizing their time of reckoning had come.
"Come on," I said. "Who wants to get whacked off first?" "I don't think you understand," said Bert. "We don't want you to whack us off."
He was so pathetic, standing there groveling for mercy, that I almost felt sorry for him. But no. They'd beaten me up too many times, and they needed to answer for it. I would keep my resolve. I would show no mercy.
"Well then, you should have thought about that before you beat me until I crapped my pants, then took turns peeing on my face."
"Jesus, Donny," said Chris, "that was meant to be humiliating. Did you actually enjoy that?" I grinned at him.
"About as much as you're going to enjoy me whacking you off."
"Holy shit," said Larry. "We turned him queer."
Bert shook his head and laughed.
"As sad as this whole display is, it kind of makes me want to kick your ass even more."
The others nodded in agreement. I started to get furious at this point. even as I stood before them, shirtless and slathered with lube, my multitude of colorful karate belts hanging from my waist, they weren't taking me seriously. The perfect attack formed in my mind. First, a flying sidekick straight into Bert's chest, followed by a roundhouse to Chris's face. Then I'd punch through Larry and Brad's stomachs, grab their spines, and twist until I felt them snap. I'd let Bert and Chris get up again so that I could whack them off some more before I snapped their spines. Empowered by my focused rage, I ran at Bert and leaped foot first at him. Hi-ya! Bert stepped to the side and thrust his fist down into my face as I sailed past. The back of my head slammed into the ground, which was about as yielding as Bert's fist. The next few minutes felt like days as I lay helpless in a cacophony of shouts and jeers as an endless barrage of feet literally kicked the crap out of me. "Aw, man," said Chris when the kicking finally stopped. "He went and shat himself again." Bert laughed. "Let's piss on him again." I was relieved, having been fearing that he might recognize the smell of his missing pizza rolls. I dared not open my eyes, but heard the distinct sound of zippers coming down. As I lay in agony, waiting to get peed on like a dead raccoon, I wondered how they defeated me so badly after all my training.
"That's enough,"
shouted my dad as the screen door slammed against the side of the trailer.
"Y'all get on out of here before I take a piss on you."
I cracked one eye open to find him standing at the bottom of the steps, completely naked with his wiener in his hand, as if to reinforce his threat.
"Shit," said Bert. "Let's go."
"Say hi to your daddy for me,"
Mom called out to Bert from the doorway. She was also naked. When Bert and his gang were far enough away, I opened my other eye. Mom and Dad were standing nakedly over me. "Thanks, guys," I said. "Bert Fargle and his friends beat me up again."
"I know, honey," said Mom. "We watched the whole thing."
Something seemed wrong with that.
"Then why didn't you come out earlier?"
Mom smiled sympathetically.
"I wanted to, but your daddy noticed that you didn't bring home the beer he asked you to get."
"Do you want to explain yourself, boy?"
said Dad. He sounded pretty angry.
"I'm sorry, Dad. I meant to get your beer, but I
ain't talking about the goddamn beer. I'd like to know why you was trying to whack off a bunch of boys in my front yard, and why you come home half-naked, wearing rainbows and shit, all covered in..."
He ran a finger across my chest, then rubbed his fingers together.
"Is this lube?"
"It's Boner Bob's all-purpose lube," I explained. "It's amazing stuff, Dad. You've really got to try it."
Dad shook his head.
"Jesus fucking Christ, this is why you don't let other boys piss on you. Ain't I warned you about that?"
"Yes, sir, but I didn't let them. They just..."
"What will the neighbors think?"
Dad scratched behind his balls with one hand and waved to Mr. Grimmond across the street, who had come out to check his mail.
"He thought it was Halloween. He's dressed as, clown vomit."
"But it's only April," said Mr. Grimmond.
Dad shrugged.
"He's a little retarded."
Mr. Grimmond chuckled.
"Kids. But he totally ain't queer,"
Dad added. Mr. Grimmond looked past Dad to my mom.
"I've still got that dead possum in my backyard. We still on for tonight?"
Mom squeezed her bare boobs together and batted her eyelashes.
"That all depends. Did you pick me up a Powerball ticket?"
"Right here,"
said Mr. Grimmond with a wink as he patted his shirt pocket.
"Then I'll start filling up the old bladder and I'll see you tonight."
When Mr. Grimmond went inside, Mom looked down at me. Her face was serious.
"Donny, I got a call from your teacher at school today."
"Oh no, I'd been caught."
"I'm sorry I skipped school today. I can explain.
Dad's stern look derailed my train of thought.
Was you out whacking boys off?
I shook my head. Dad nodded.
All right, then.
That ain't what he called about Donnie, Mom continued. In fact, it don't really matter now if you go to school or not. I got it set up so that you're gonna get straight D's down the line. I propped myself up on my elbows. How's that? Dad chuckled.
Your mom was gonna get his straight D, if you catch my meaning.
I didn't, but I sure did appreciate whatever it was. One less thing to worry about. The familiarly salty taste of blood was heavy in my mouth as I grinned up at her. Thanks, Mom.
Your mama sucks a lot of dicks for you, Donnie, said Dad. It ain't right for you to walk around dressed like that, bringing dishonor to our family name.
Yes, sir. Dad poked a foot around in the tall grass until he spotted movement. With instincts he claimed to have inherited due to his mother humping mountain lions in the local circus, he pounced on his prey, then stood back up with a squealing rat in his hands. It stopped squealing when he twisted its neck.
Come on over here, Donnie,
he said, tossing the dead rat down onto one of the paving stones that led up to the front steps of the trailer. He turned to Mom.
Jolene?
But I got that appointment with Mr. Grimmond, said Mom.
That ain't for another couple of hours. You got plenty of time to refill. Besides, he's peeking out his window at you right now.
Mom and I looked at Mr. Grimmond's house. He waved at us through the window. We waved back. All right, fine, said Mom. We got any of that toilet gin left? Dad nodded.
We got half a bucket left, and we'll have a bunch of Coors Light once Donnie runs back to the store.
He was looking sternly at me again now. Yes, sir, I said.
Mom squatted over the dead rat and began urinating on it.
Dad clapped his hand on my shoulder as he watched. His wiener was starting to rise.
Don't that stir nothing within you, Donnie?
It made me a little sick in my stomach, but I didn't think that's what he meant. No, Dad, I can't rightly say it does. Mom and Dad nodded solemnly to each other. Nobody spoke as both rat and paving stone got more and more saturated with pee. When she was finished, Mom stood up and gazed sympathetically at me. Donnie, your daddy and I are concerned about you being gay. What? I said. But I'm not. I know it ain't your fault, honey.
It's all them Mexicans, said Dad, infiltrating our schools with their drugs and theories of evolution and shit.
Mom smiled. But I've got good news. You remember your Uncle Jimmy? I spat out some blood and thought about it. Ain't he the one that hung himself? That's right. But before all that, he was cured by gay conversion therapy. That's great, I said. But I ain't...
Listen, retard, said Dad. It ain't too late to abort you. So I don't want to hear no back talk. This therapist is costing us more than just a little bit of dick sucking.
Yes, sir.
He wants me to spank him while he shits in a diaper and sucks your mama's strap on.
I didn't know how to respond to that. Oh.
The point I'm making is that we're making sacrifices for you. When you go around town telling other boys to piss on your face, that ain't showing us the proper respect we deserve.
The course this conversation had taken was beginning to make me uncomfortable. Rather than try to explain again that I hadn't asked anyone to pee on my face, I nodded. Yes, sir. We love you for who you are, Donnie, said Mom.
That's right, said Dad. Now go change out of them faggot clothes and go pick me up some beer.
7.
I was still in a lot of pain as I walked to Quick Fix, and now that I was wearing a shirt and had removed all my karate belts, I felt weak and vulnerable again. But at least it felt good to have washed the poo out of my pants. After having bailed on Gary the Hobo in the middle of his performance, I didn't have the nerve to ask him for another favor so soon. So I approached from the front of the store and tried to think of another strategy. Then a brilliant idea came to me. Rabies didn't seem that hard to fake. I already looked pretty bad from having the crap kicked out of me. All I'd have to do is chew on some Alka-Seltzer until I started foaming at the mouth, then chase customers around and try to bite them. I went inside and headed straight for the pharmacy aisle. Old man Puckett didn't even look up from his copy of Hustle Whore. There were three customers in the shop, one of which was an elderly woman in the same aisle as me. I couldn't very well start chewing on stolen Alka-Seltzer right in front of her. That would spoil the ruse. So I waited for her to finish her business there and move on to a different aisle.
"Excuse me, young man," said the old woman. "Can you help me find the right brand of adult diaper?"
That seemed like a better question to ask old man Puckett, but the last thing I needed was another person in this aisle with me. I scanned the selection, trying to pick out what was different about each one. Do you need extra absorption, or long-lasting, or... The woman chuckled.
"Oh, these aren't for me, they're for my son. He's a therapist."
Her tone suggested that I should be impressed. "You must be very proud." She squinted at the diapers again.
"He specifically requested the brand with the Muppet Babies print, but I can't seem to find them."
I looked up and down, but couldn't find anything that looked like Muppet Babies. "I don't see anything like that."
"Maybe I ought to ask the manager. He might have some in the back."
"No!" The last thing I needed was old man Puckett here, too. I grabbed the nearest pack off the shelf. "I think he was talking about these." I read the brand name. "Wrinkle Tinkle." The old woman took the pack and looked at it doubtfully.
"Are you sure?" "He's very particular about his diapers."
"Absolutely sure. My, mom uses these. The names are interchangeable." She shrugged.
"Well, if you say so."
She put the diapers in her cart, then reached down her dress under her bra. When she pulled her hand back out, she was holding an unwrapped stick of gum, which she then held out to me.
"Thank you."
"No, thank you," I said, taking the gum and popping it into my mouth. She'd sweated out most of the flavor, but there was still a hint of spearmint. After she'd been so kind to me, I didn't have the heart to chase her around the store and bite her. And if the gum was anything to go by, she didn't taste very good anyway. So I waited for her to finish her purchases and leave before I opened a bottle of Alka-Seltzer and shook half a dozen tablets into my mouth. The gum chewing had gotten my saliva flowing pretty good. That, combined with the blood, made for a great foamy froth. I leaped out growling into the canned food aisle. A young woman screamed as she shoved her shopping cart at me. It smashed me into the shelves. As cans of sweet corn, peas, and green beans rained down on my head, I thought that it might be wise to be a little more selective of my target next time. This woman's cart was full of some heavy stuff.
"Rabies!" she screamed as she ran out the door.
"Son of a bitch," said old man Puckett.
It only occurred to me when I heard the click of his giant revolver that the rabies guy was meant to be the distraction. Fearing for my life, I scrambled out from under the pile of cans while thinking about what the safest route to the exit would be. Then I heard the back door open.
"Gary!"
shouted old man Puckett.
"What?"
said Gary the hobo.
"You want to watch me piss on this..."
"Jesus! I warned you not to bother my customers no more!"
My plan hadn't worked exactly as I expected, but this distraction was as good as any. When I heard the first gunshot, I ran straight for the beer cooler. This time, I grabbed two cases of Coors Light. They would be heavy to carry back home, but it would be nice to give old man Puckett a day to cool down before I tried the same trick again. I hoped he wasn't killing Gary. Otherwise, I was going to have to think up an entirely different strategy. Beer in hand, I ran toward the front door, thankful that I didn't also have to pick up cigarettes. Then I thought about what Larry had said about Wendy.
"Ain't a whole lot that girl won't do for a pack of menthols."
I wondered if that included going steady with me. Once she spent more time with me, she'd see I was the perfect man to help her raise Reggie Jr. If there was anything worth me risking a bullet for, it was buying Wendy's affection with a pack of cigarettes. Unfortunately, all the cigarettes had been stocked, so I'd have to climb up on the counter to reach them. Larry hadn't specified a particular brand she liked, and there were so many to choose from. I searched for a name that would best convey my feelings for her. There didn't seem to be any brands called True Love or I Want to Be the Father of Your Cousin Reggie's Baby, so I went with the next best thing. I seemed to recall her saying something once about how much she liked humping, so I grabbed a pack of Camels.
"Hey!" shouted Old Man Puckett as I pulled the pack out of the dispenser.
Oh, no. I looked just in time to see him raise his gun at me. I was about as open a target as I could possibly be.
Boom!
The gunshot was even louder in the store than I remembered it being when I was outside squatting next to the dumpster. I fell backwards onto the floor, already in so much pain that I didn't know if I'd been shot or not. Then I saw the cash register on the floor next to me. It had a pretty big bullet hole in the back of it, and I was pretty sure it hadn't just a minute ago. The drawer had opened and the cash had spilled out everywhere. I swiped a few 20s and stuffed them in my pocket just in case I made it out of there alive. Old Man Puckett hobbled around to the back of the counter and scowled at me. The shiny barrel of his gun was aimed directly at my face.
"Just what do you think you're doing, young man?"
I thought up a story as quickly as I could. "I came in, but nobody was here, so I was just going to take what I needed and leave the money on the counter." Old Man Puckett grinned as he uncocked his gun.
"Well, why didn't you say so?"
"You were shooting at me." He laughed heartily, coughing up what sounded like a quart of phlegm, but he didn't spit it out.
"A good, honest boy. Too few and far between these days. You remind me a lot of myself when I was your age. Tell me, son, have you ever touched an old man's balls?"
I thought about it for a moment. "No, I don't think so, sir." He winked at me.
"Oh, you'd remember."
His wide grin flickered when he saw the cigarettes in my hand, and he cocked his gun again.
"Menthols, huh? You ain't by any chance that queer kid who's been running around town trying to whack off other boys, are you?"
"No, sir." I held up the cigarettes. "These are, for my little sister." The truth would have been simpler than bringing up my aborted sister, but I found it difficult to think straight with a gun pointed at my face.
"Will the cigarettes be all?"
he asked, professional to the point of unfriendly. I scooted past him with my back against the counter. "These two cases of beer, too." I put $60 down on the counter, shoved the cigarettes in my pocket, grabbed the beer, and headed for the door.
"Now you wait just a goddamn minute,"
demanded Old Man Puckett. "Oh, crap, what now?" I froze in terror. If he intended to shoot me, was it better to run or address him? Since he hadn't shot me during my moment of hesitation, I opted for the latter. I turned around. "Yes, sir." Old Man Puckett slapped a couple of bills and coins on the counter.
"Don't forget your change."
Was it a dare? Was he toying with me? I was torn between taking the change and running as fast as I could out of the shop. Old Man Puckett grinned at me again.
"Or might you like to spend it on a magazine instead? This one's got twin girls pissing on each other."
He held up his copy of Hustle Whore.
"That is, unless you're a faggot."
This was clearly a test. Passing would mean me getting out of there alive. Failure would mean me getting shot in the face. I considered explaining to him that I already owned a copy of that issue of Hustle Whore, but then reconsidered. It only seemed fair, considering that I stole the money that I was paying for this with, as well as the initial copy of Hustle Whore back in my room. Thank you, sir, I said, as I accepted the strangely moist magazine. Then I picked up my beer and hurried out the door, thankful to still be alive when I made it outside. 8. I was exhausted when I finally made it home again. Figuring Mom was probably across the street with Mr. Grimmond by now, I thought I might be able to sneak in the back door and hide one case of beer in my room. Unfortunately, Dad wasn't in the bathroom for once. He was sitting at the kitchen table with a somber look on his face. "What's wrong, Dad?" I asked.
"I just got a phone call. You'd better sit down."
Who could it have been this time? Were we getting sued because one of the boys in Bert Fargle's gang hurt their foot while they were kicking me? Did old man Puckett call about me faking rabies in his store? Had my teacher changed his mind about giving me all D's? I sat down across the table from my dad.
"Well, put the goddamn beer in the fridge first, retard," said Dad.
As I emptied the boxes into the refrigerator, all kinds of possibilities ran through my mind as to who might have called and what kind of trouble I might be in. My heart nearly stopped. Did someone spot me in Sensei's yard? Oh man, if Dad found out I was hanging out with a Chinaman, I was in deep, especially since he already thought I was gay. I suddenly became extremely aware of the pack of menthols in my pocket. When I was done stocking the fridge, I sat down at the table again and braced myself to face the music.
So, what was the phone call about?
Remember that gay conversion therapist your mama talked about earlier?
I nodded.
Well, he's been hauled off to jail for killing his mother.
Oh, no!
Word on the street is she bought him the wrong brand of diaper, and he up and lost his shit on her.
I gasped. That's terrible!
He brained her with the nut end of a steel dildo. When the cops found him, he was whacking off over her dead body.
A small knot of worry started to form in my gut. Did they say what his preferred brand of diaper was? Dad shrugged.
I don't know. Some Jim Henson characters or whatever.
I sighed, worried that it might have been the same old lady I had talked to at Quick Fix. That's a relief.
Relief? Said Dad. What the fuck is wrong with you?
Crap, had I said that out loud? No, I meant, she was old, right? Her best years were probably behind her anyway.
Who gives a fuck about some wrinkly old bitch? You got dried up jizz in your ears, Donnie? I said your gay conversion therapist has been arrested. Do you know what that means?
Sure I do, I said. That's when the police come and take someone away.
God damn it, retard. It means that we ain't gonna be able to take you to therapy.
Oh. Well, maybe that's not such a bad thing. You see, I'm not actually...
I appreciate the effort you're making, son, said Dad as he looked down at old man Puckett's moist copy of Hustle Whore on the table in front of me. But this ain't something you can just fake your way through. I was watching you while you was watching your mama take a piss on that dead rat. I could see in your eyes that there weren't even a spark of arousal in you.
I didn't know what to say. He was right about that. I'm sorry, Dad.
We're just gonna have to find some other way.
He stared teary-eyed at the plastic crucifix that covered the hole he'd punched in the wall when I came home with lime-flavored Bud Light. What did you have in mind?
This one time, when I was just a few years younger than you, my daddy caught me smoking a menthol cigarette.
Oh? I gulped. The rectangular bulge in my pocket felt like a mountain.
He beat the shit out of me, then locked me in a closet with your mama, my sister at the time. He didn't let us out until you was conceived.
Mom had told me about them being locked in the closet together about 1,000 times, but she had never mentioned anything about the beating, or that she and Dad used to be brother and sister. Dad shook his head.
If I hadn't aborted your sister, maybe you would appreciate the love of a woman.
There are other women out there, I said, like Wendy Peters next door.
This ain't no time for joking, boy, said Dad. I mean, don't get me wrong, that little whore's a great lay, but I think she's a little bit out of your league, don't you?
That wasn't the direction I'd hoped to steer the conversation in. Maybe it would be better to focus on the beating. If he gave me a good beating, I could tell him I was suddenly attracted to girls. Only he might actually believe me. So you're gonna whack my gay off?
Jesus, Donny!
Dad shook his head and stood up. He grabbed two beers from the refrigerator and guzzled one down as fast as he could.
It's spread too deep inside you. Why didn't we see the signs earlier? This is gonna take more than an ass-whooping, I'm afraid. Run on to your room now, and I'll talk to your mama when she gets home and see if there's anything we can do besides put you down.
Thankful to be excused, I grabbed my second copy of Hustle Whore and dashed to my room. When I opened my window to let some of the roaches out, I could smell the faintest trace of poo in the air. Wendy, I whispered, is that you?
Donnie,
she whispered back from the other side of the overgrown hedge next to the trailer.
Boy, am I glad to hear your voice.
My heart quickened in my chest.
Oh, yeah? You got any toilet paper on you? I forgot to bring a roll.
The last thing I needed was to get caught squandering what was left of our toilet paper, but I certainly didn't want to miss out on a chance to show Wendy Peters that I could provide for her.
How's this?
I asked, tossing my hustle whore past the hedge. Her hand poked out from the other side of the hedge and snatched up the magazine.
Donnie, are you sure? This is the issue everyone's been talking about. The one with twins pissing on each other.
Don't worry, I got another copy.
Why's this one so moist? She asked. And why does it smell like old man Puckett's splooge?
I scrambled to come up with an answer, but then I heard the pages start tearing and figured she'd moved on. One by one, crumpled magazine pages bounced into view like baby rabbits covered in poo.
Thanks, said Wendy when she was done.
She waddled into view, zipping up her tight jean shorts, then handed me what was left of the magazine.
These are a lot softer than guns and ammo.
You can keep that if you like. Wendy looked at the ground.
I think I'd rather just keep borrowing it from you.
My sweaty palms further moistened the rolled-up magazine. Was she hinting at something? Had she been taking dumps in my yard because she wanted an excuse to see me? No, that couldn't be the case. I must be reading too much into what she said. Maybe she didn't want to get caught with a magazine featuring twin girls peeing on each other. Now that I thought about it, that was the much likelier explanation. But then why did she look so shy when she said it?
Stop it, Donnie. She's out of your league. You're getting your hopes up over nothing. And you're only going to end up making a fool of yourself. You won't have the slightest hint of a chance with this girl until you do something to show her you're more of a man than she thinks you are. You need to whack off Bert Fargle and his friends first, then focus on Wendy.
Sure, I said, setting the magazine on the broken washing machine that I used as a desk. It'll be right here whenever you need it.
That's real sweet of you, Donnie.
She looked down again, but this time her eyes looked sad.
I heard you tried to whack off Bert Fargle.
I nodded.
Yeah, it didn't go as well as I'd expected.
Donnie, you can't keep throwing yourself at these boys and expect them to show mercy. That's your problem. You got too big a heart in you. You want to please everybody, but you just can't. Guys like Bert Fargle, they don't see you like I do. When you try to whack them off, they just take it as a sign of weakness.
I just ain't trained enough is all. I got another lesson scheduled for tomorrow.
I leaned in closer. Don't tell nobody, but I've been training with Mr. Mitsubishi, the old Chinaman who lives at the end of the block. Wendy gasped.
You shouldn't be hanging around him, Donnie. My daddy said he ate my dog shit for brains last summer.
Something didn't add up with that story. I distinctly remembered finding her dog dead in the woods last summer, looking like it had taken a shotgun blast to the face. I supposed it was possible that Mr. Mitsubishi had come along later and brought it home to eat, but Wendy's warning seemed to imply that he had been the one to kill it. I kept my mouth shut about it on account of I didn't want to seem like I was calling Wendy's daddy a liar. If my dreams were ever going to come true, I wouldn't be doing myself any favors by casting aspersions on the character of a man I hoped to one day call father-in-law. "Don't you worry about me," I said. "I'll be real careful." "Why are you learning to whack boys off from some old Chinaman anyway? I'd be more than happy to teach you." "That's real nice of you to offer, but as a matter of fact, I could whack you off right now if you want me to." I laughed in spite of the pain in my chest. "Thank you, but I think I've gotten quite enough whacking in for one day." Wendy glanced at the copy of Hustle Whore on my table, then grinned at me. "Well, if you ever change your mind, you just let me know next time I come to take a shit in your yard." I grinned back at her. "By this time tomorrow, I might have a thing or two to teach you about whacking boys off. I'm gonna have a black belt." "That does sound like some intense training," said Wendy. "All this time I thought it was just a matter of spitting in your palm and jiggling the sack a bit. Maybe let him finger your butthole if that's what he's into." "We ain't covered those techniques yet, but I reckon Mr. Mitsubishi takes a more holistic approach to his training. Maybe after I'm done training, we can swap more specific tips. I'll show you how I rub Boner Bob's all-purpose lube all over my body, and you can demonstrate your butthole maneuver for me."
I'd love that, Donny."
Wendy was starting to sweat and breathing real heavy. I was half worried she was going into labor. Her heavy breathing reminded me of something I'd almost forgotten. I reached in my pocket and pulled out the pack of menthols I'd bought her. "I picked these up for you earlier when I was shopping. I didn't know if this was the brand you like, but..."
"Oh, Donny!"
She snatched the pack out of my hand and tore off the wrapper like it was a box of Christmas Slim Jims. Once she had one lit and took a few drags, she calmed down. She turned away from me, but I saw the tear she was trying to hide as it rolled down her cheek.
"What's wrong, Wendy?" I asked. "I can take those back and get you a different brand if you want. I just remembered you saying how much you liked humping, so I picked camels, you know, 'cause they got humps."
Wendy sniffled back what sounded like a quart of snot, then smiled at me. Both of her cheeks shined in the bug zapper light with tear streaks.
"These are perfect, Donny. It's just that ain't nobody never given me a pack of smokes before without wanting something in return. I thought all men was the same. Here's some menthols, Wendy, if you let me put my finger in your butthole, or you gotta put your finger in my butthole, or first I want to watch you take a piss on that dead frog. But you're different, Donny. There's something special about you, a decency that I didn't know existed in this town."
"Thanks," I said, only half paying attention since she'd mentioned taking a piss on a dead frog.
"I got a secret to tell you, Donny," said Wendy. She sounded dead serious.
"What is it?" I made a quick, silent prayer that Reggie hadn't proposed to her.
"You know our teacher, Mr. Paulson?"
"Kinda."
"He offered me a whole carton of smokes if I'd come over to his house and take a shit on his chest."
I sighed with relief. While I wasn't sure where she was going with this, my concerns about her cousin at least appeared to be unfounded.
"That's nice."
Wendy took a long drag from her cigarette, then wiped the tears out of her eyes.
"But I came to take a shit in your yard instead. Do you know why, Donny?"
I shrugged. "You couldn't hold it?" She blew a thick cloud of minty smoke in my face. Before I knew what was happening, I felt her hand on the back of my head. She pulled me toward her, then licked me from my chin, over my mouth, nose, and left eye. All kinds of feelings welled up from within me, including a strange tingly sensation in my wiener. I stood there dumbstruck, no more able to move than Gary the Hobo's dead raccoon. "I'll see you tomorrow night," said Wendy, looking back at me as she walked toward her trailer. I felt a surge of confidence akin to what I felt earlier in the day when I was walking down the street shirtless and covered in lube, with all my karate belts hanging from my waist.
"You'll see tomorrow, Wendy. I'm going to whack off Bert and his gang like they ain't never been whacked off before."
"You do what you gotta do, Donnie. Good night."
9. I sneaked out of the window early the next morning in case Mom and Dad had any new ideas about my gay conversion therapy. They'd see I didn't need therapy when I came back from whacking off Bert Fargle. After all the intense training I'd been through the day before, I was determined to not let anything get in the way of earning my black belt.
"Oh, shit," said Sensei into his cell phone when I approached his porch. He cupped his hand over the side of his mouth. "It's that retarded kid I was telling you about from up the street. I'll call you back."
He shoved the phone in his pocket and grinned broadly at me.
"Donny-san, you come back now? Complete training?"
I nodded. "Your phone English is really good, Sensei."
"No was me speaking. I watching movie on hand phone about retarded boy, Forrest Gump. You see, Tom Hanks very funny."
"It sure did sound like your voice."
"Smack! Shut your mouth, Donny-san. Time to begin training. Now take off shirt."
I took off my shirt and pulled all the belts I'd earned yesterday out of my bag. One by one, I tied them around my waist. While I was tying my red belt, it occurred to me that something of Sensei's was missing. "Hey, Sensei, where's your special chair?"
"Backyard," he smiled. "Today you earn black belt. Very special training. Follow me."
"But don't I need to put on my lube first?" Sensei laughed.
"No worry, it's part of training."
As we walked around the side of the house, I wondered if the squeals coming from the backyard had anything to do with my training. There wasn't much more to our backyard than the pit we burned our garbage in, but Sensei's yard was filled with features I assumed were more popular in the Orient. Most notable was the centerpiece. A large inflatable swimming pool was surrounded by a wire fence. 50 or 60 empty buckets of Boner Bob's all-purpose lube surrounded it, their former contents filling the pool up to 4 inches deep. Staring back at us through the fence from inside the pool was a big, fat, pink sow, easily weighing 150 pounds. It grunted as poo fell out of its butt and splattered on top of the lube.
"I didn't know you had a pet pig," I said. "What's her name?"
Sensei shook his head.
"No is pet, is final training."
"You want me to take her for a walk?"
"You and pig fight to death!"
He gestured to the belt suspended in a loop from the top of his special chair on his back deck.
"Winner get black belt. Become karate master."
As challenging as each of yesterday's tasks had been, none of them felt so daunting as this. That thing was heavier than I was. I don't know if I got it in me to kill that pig with my bare hands.
"No be little bitch baby. Where you think bacon come from?"
The freezers of my mom's clients? That had always been my understanding.
Smack! "It come from pig! If you can't kill pig, how you expect kill boys who beat shit out of you?"
I raised my hands defensively. "Oh, Sensei, you got me all wrong. I don't want to kill those boys. I just want to whack them off a little so they'll stop picking on me."
Sensei looked shocked at first, then thoughtful as he stroked his little white beard. Finally, he nodded.
"First, you fight pig. Then I teach you how whack off boys."
I beamed at him and gave him a thumbs up.
"You got yourself a deal, Sensei."
Sensei swallowed a couple of his blue allergy pills as he hurried up the deck steps, then sat in his chair and slipped the black belt over his head. I couldn't see what he was doing after that because everything below his chest was obscured by a towel hanging over the railing, but he seemed to be adjusting his pants. When he was done, he nodded down at me.
Begin!
I climbed over the fence, jumped into the pool, and immediately lost my footing. Boner Bob's all-purpose lube sure is slippery. I could hear Sensei laughing as I struggled to get back on my feet. In less than a minute, I was covered in even more lube than I'd been covered in the day before. It was everywhere. In my ears, down my pants, up my nose. Some of it that had gotten in my mouth tasted like it might have a trace of pig poo in it. I spat it out, stabilized myself on my hands and knees as best I could, then stared down my adversary. She stared back, seemingly more out of curiosity than malice. Crawling at her as fast as I could while maintaining my tenuous balance, I attempted to ram her in the side with my head. She didn't budge.
No! Shouted Sensei. I teach you nothing! To defeat pig, you must rub body against pig's body!
Of course! Honestly, aside from wrestling the inflatable opponent, most of yesterday's training hadn't made a whole lot of sense to me. But now it was all coming together. Karate wasn't about kicks and punches like they did it on TV. That's where I'd gone wrong in my confrontation with Bert Fargle's gang yesterday. True karate is about rubbing yourself down with lube and rubbing your semi-naked body against other people. Next time I faced Bert, he'd be in for a big surprise. With my newly acquired ancient Chinese wisdom, I climbed on top of the sow, straddling her between my arms and legs. Only then did she take any countermeasures, or even seemed to realize that she was in a fight. The pig squealed and squirmed out of my grip, but she wasn't any better at navigating the slippery terrain than I was. I was back on top of her in no time.
Yes, yes, cried Sensei. Now slap her on backside and call her little bitch baby.
I gave the pig's butt a good hard smack.
Take that, you little bitch baby.
My heart was beating so fast. I'd never shouted a cuss word before.
Slap harder, demanded Sensei. You tell her you doing fine since divorce. You always want fuck her sister anyway.
I looked up at him, a little confused as to what he was talking about.
What?
Sensei was red in the face and sweating profusely.
Just say it, goddammit!
Okay. I slapped the pig's butt as hard as I could. I've been doing fine since the divorce, and I want to fuck my sister.
No, stupid boy,
shouted Sensei, pounding the railing with his fist.
No, fuck you, sister. You want fuck wife, sis. Crack. Shit!
The broken railing fell to the ground, and Sensei fell after it. Fortunately, his chair got caught on something, and the black belt around his neck kept him from falling all the way to the ground. Relieved that he was okay, I laughed because Sensei wasn't wearing any pants. His stiffened wiener was as red as his face.
Donny, son,
he struggled to say while he clawed at the belt around his neck.
Help me.
You want me to fix your pants? I hoped he wasn't going to ask me to fix the railing. I'm not so good with tools.
Untie belt.
Sensei's face was purple now, and I could barely understand what he was saying. It felt like kind of a weird request, but I did as I was told and started untying the knots on my belts. I hoped he wasn't going to ask me to take off my pants, too.
Donny,
croaked Sensei.
Black. Belt, take off my neck.
I don't understand, Sensei. You want me to take off your neck? Wouldn't that kill you?
Take the belt off my neck.
My heart nearly stopped. You mean to say I earned my black belt? I'm a karate master now?
Sensei rolled his bulging eyes.
Yes!
His voice was so faint now that I almost couldn't hear him.
Please, hurry.
I tried to climb up Sensei's leg, but I was too slippery from all that lube. As hard as I tried, all I managed to do was rub myself up and down his leg. He might have offered me a hand, but he was too busy using it to yank on his wiener, much in the same way Gary the Hobo had done while he was looking at Hustle Whore.
I can't reach it, I finally said.
Sensei said nothing in return. In fact, he was completely still now, both hands hanging limp at his side. I nodded in understanding. He couldn't help me. This was my final test. If I wanted to be a true karate master, I had to earn that black belt myself. I considered trying to use the pig as a step stool, but we were both covered in lube now, and I didn't expect she'd be very cooperative after I'd slapped her and shouted cuss words at her. Then my wandering gaze fell upon the deck stairs.
That's it, ain't it? I said, looking up at Sensei. I can unfasten the belt from the chair.
Sensei remained perfectly still.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.